It's been 2.5 years since I bought my very first Mazda MX-5 Miata. So in this video, I'm going to give you a long-term ownership review of the 2018 Mazda MX-5 Miata to see if the Miata is always the answer. Let's do this. Hello again, guys. I'm Reagan, and you know what, one morning I just realized that I haven't truly done an in-depth review of my very own car, my 2018 Mazda MX-5 Miata. Well, I guess it's better late than never, and it's probably even better now because after 2.5 years of ownership, I can now give you a truly in-depth review, ownership review of this fantastic car. In this video, I'll share with you what it's like to be the owner of an MX-5 ND for over 2 years, point out any issues that I've encountered, if there are any, and determine if she is truly a keeper car. You see, right now, my mileage stands at around 11,000 kilometers, which I know, guys, that's not too much for over 2 years of ownership. But, well, my Scarlett is a manual. It's a 6-speed manual, and I don't daily drive her because it's truly no fun going around severe Manila traffic with a manual. I mean, you'd mostly stay in a first gear and neutral most of the time, so it's really no fun to do that. Now, that is pretty much my first tip for my viewers out there. If you plan to daily drive your MX-5 Miata ND or RF and you live in an area where there's severe traffic, bumper-to-bumper traffic like what we have here in Manila, well, you might as well go for the automatic version of the MX-5 because there's really no shame in getting an automatic MX-5, at least in the ND or RF configuration, because it is one of the sweetest automatic transmissions that you could buy brand new in today's times. But since my Scarlett is pretty much a weekend car, so the manual transmission is the only option for me. Starting off with the looks, as you can see, Scarlett has aged gracefully over those past 2 years. Her body lines are still beautiful, and I just love how the front fender bulges up like that and flows all the way into the doors, even inside the door panel, and it just finishes off into this nice, sexy rear hunch. I mean, look at that. Even after 2 years, I still look back at her when I park her in the parking lot, and I still feel my heart fluttering whenever I see those sexy curves. Now, as you can see, my paint is original Soul Red paint. This is not the Soul Red crystal that can be found in newer MX-5 ND2s, but the paint has stood well through the test of time. It's still shiny and, well, it's still as gorgeous and as eye-catching as it used to be when I first got the car. Now, if you notice, I lowered Scarlett a little bit on my Cusco coilovers, which made her look a little bit wider and a little bit longer. And that is a good thing for such a tiny car because everybody knows that the MX-5 Miata is such a tiny car. And by making it look a little bit longer and a little bit wider, it gives it a little bit more road presence. Now, when it comes to my soft top, well, after 2 years of ownership, the soft top still remains good even after enduring harsh tropical heat and sun and severe Manila typhoons that we encounter here. I haven't encountered any waterproofing issues with my soft top. There are no water leaks that I've encountered from the windows. Even inside the cabin, there's no water leaks at all. So that also attests the waterproofness of this fabric top. And it also helps that I maintain my fabric top with a 303 fabric guard. So that keeps it in good shape. I also haven't encountered any problems with a soft top in terms of rubbing or fraying of the fabric itself. I guess the Mazda has already solved that problem with these late model ND1s that came out. Mine's a 2018. So yeah, or probably I just got lucky, I guess. I don't know. But I always put the top down as much as possible, and I haven't had any roll hoop rubbing issues. Moving on to the trunk, well, Miatas are never really known to have a decent trunk space, and the MX-5 ND and the RF has the smallest trunk volume amongst all four generations of the Miata. But even at 4.5 cubic feet of trunk space, I never truly found it wanting in my 2 years of ownership of my car. Well, that would probably be a different issue if Scarlett would be my daily driver and I'd be pulling a lot of groceries from Costco or SNR or Landers every so often. But that's not the case since I have other bigger cars. So as you can see, the trunk itself is adequate enough to fit a couple of overnight bags. We've done an overnight road trip to Baler Aurora with another MCP member, and we were able to fit a good amount of stuff in the Scarlett's trunk. We put our overnight bags, and I also put in my photography and video equipment as well. So it was able to swallow everything, to fit everything. So even after 2 years, I never found the trunk to be an issue in my MX-5 Miata NV. Now when you open the hood of the MX-5, you will realize that you have one of the most beautiful engines that you can have for under 2 million pesos. You see, Mazda decided to forego on any sort of engine cover on their MX-5 RF and ND offerings. So because of that, you can now see your 2-liter inline-4 Skyactiv engine in all of its aluminum glory. Now granted, my MX-5 is an ND1, which means that it only puts out 155 horsepower and 200 newton meters of torque. But I can say that after 2 years of ownership, I never found her power to be wanting. It's perfectly adequate for street use. It's actually more than adequate for street use. And I feel that the MX-5 ND is faster than like 90% of the cars that can be found in Manila roads. She just feels so quick and accelerates off the line so nicely that and keeps you within safe and legal speed limits at the same time. Now, if you'll notice, I have an aftermarket front strut bar here because local MX-5 NDs that come in manual configuration do not have the stock front strut brace. So I decided to turn to the aftermarket and install this Costco front strut bar. Now, when it comes to seats, my MX-5 Miata ND comes in cloth seats. Now, these are the seats of the base trim MX-5. I got the base trim because I wanted the 6-speed manual transmission, and it also comes in a limited slip differential, which every Miata owner knows is a must to have when you are driving an MX-5. Now, that kind of turned out to be a pretty good decision that I went with the cloth seats because they keep my back cool at all times, and the finish, the material of the seats are pretty similar to the same cloth that could be found in aftermarket racing seats. Now, granted, the seats are quite thin, and after 7 hours of driving through mountain twisties, this incredibly thin and light seat was already giving my bum a hard time. I mean, my butt already hurts after 7 hours of driving through twisties in these seats. And well, in terms of bolstering, although this is a sports car, it doesn't really have too much bolstering, at least for these stock seats. Now, I can't say the same for the Recaro spec seats of the higher trims of the MX-5, but the base stock seats are, well, I find myself sliding a lot of the times when I do a track day and I'm taking corners more aggressively. So I'm actually tempted to replace these with aftermarket sport seats, sport buckets, but I don't want to lose the functionality of my headrest Bluetooth speakers, which the stock seats have. You have Bluetooth speakers here that allows you to take calls and hear the other person in the other line, even when you're driving with the top down and at highway speed. So I don't want to lose that. So that's why I'm still on the fence if I'm going to upgrade my stock seats to more comfortable sport buckets. Now, when it comes to the interior quality and the trimmings, I'm quite happy with it. I don't hear any squeaks or rattles coming from the dashboard, from the door sidings and all that. So the interior quality has held up well. There's no fading of the plastics. There's no cracks that happened. So granted, it's been only 2 years, but still overall, I'm happy with it. Now, there is one thing that I have to share with you guys is that when you push the seat all the way back and the seat back would hit the roll hoop cover, it would sometimes generate a creak
It would squeak and it would creak. So luckily I'm only 5'6" and I don't really need to push my seat all the way back, so I could have a tiny bit of space, as you can see here. I don't know if you could see it, I have a tiny bit of space between the seat back and the roll bar, so I don't really have that kind of squeaks. But if you're a taller driver than me and you want to push your seat back all the way back, well, that is something that you'll have to live with. It's going to squeak at you and you're going to hear it, and it's kind of annoying. All right, another thing that I also noticed in my 2 years of ownership is that when the soft top is up, you would sometimes hear some creaks and rattles that are coming from the soft top itself, the mechanism of the soft top. Well, I guess that's pretty normal when you own a soft top convertible. So there's that. It's just something that you have to live with, and I've learned to live with it. Doesn't really bother me too much. Well, it kind of helps also that I have an aftermarket exhaust that is loud AF. Now, when it comes to interior storage, well, one of the first videos I made with my MX-5 was how to maximize the storage in such a tiny car. If you haven't watched that video yet, you could click the link right here, right? But after 2 years of ownership, I don't really find the interior storage wanting. You don't have a glove box at all, and I don't really miss it. I still have that center cubby right here in the middle, and this is where I park most of my, my stuff, like my gloves, some tissues, and all that. And I also have this space which I still put my glasses on after 2 years of ownership. Is still there. I also parked some coins there as well. But yeah, given the relative lack of storage, I find that it's actually an advantage, because that way you don't really keep a lot of junk inside your car. And as you could see, even after 2 years, the only thing that you could see in my cabin is this red charging cable, and that's it. It keeps my MX-5's interior still looking really tidy, and that's a good thing. So is the Mark IV MX-5 truly a keeper? Well, if you fit in one and you don't mind the cabin noise, then definitely she's a keeper. I've had zero maintenance issues for the past 2 years, and my fuel economy has averaged 11 kilometers per liter. Yeah. And mind you guys, I don't do any fuel economy runs in this car. As much as possible, I would send it every chance I get. If you will notice, Scarlett has aged gracefully through the years, and I always look forward to taking her out for a drive every chance I get. So yes, I could say with 100% certainty that the Miata is always the answer. Once again, thank you guys for watching one of my videos. If you like this video, hit that like button. Subscribe to my channel as well. I promise you, I will make it worth your while by subscribing to my channel. Anyway guys, I'm Ray Gannon. I will see you again in another video. Bye-bye.